Yes, good morning, everyone.
Goedemorgen.
Good morning. Goedemorgen. Before I welcome everyone, can I please ask everyone to be as much as possible or totally on mute so that we have the best possible sound? And then, having said this, I'm very happy to host this first of a series of three webinars on biodiversity in cooperation with IUCN Netherlands. My name is Jacqueline Duyker, and I'm the Senior Manager, Sustainability and Responsible Investment at VBDO. So, in the three upcoming webinars, we aim to convey a meaningful dialogue on biodiversity between the financial sector and real-world biodiversity experts, and also as much as possible with all participating in the webinar. We expect a great deal of people in this webinar, and I think people will continue to drop in, as we go on. I started because we run a very tight and also a very good, very full schedule. So we should just get started. And first, I would like to introduce actually to you briefly the topic of biodiversity, if possible to do that briefly. But if you see here in the slide, the so-called wedding cake, the SDG wedding cake, as drawn up by the Stockholm Resilience Center. And it illustrates very clearly that the biosphere is actually the foundation of our society and also of our economy. So loss of biodiversity directly affects our ecosystem that forms our biosphere. And this is put now in terms of the Sustainable Development Goals of the SDGs. And it clearly states that the biosphere is actually determined fundamentally by SDG 15, the life on land, the life below water, SDG 14, SDG 13, climate action, and clean water, SDG 6. So the message here is very clear that without protecting our biodiversity, we will not be able to realize all the other SDGs, like having a livable society, let alone having a good functioning economic system. So, although the notion of the importance of biodiversity is getting traction also in the financial sector, and a great number of emerging initiatives are spotted to stop a loss, to stop the ongoing loss actually of biodiversity. It's good that so many things are happening, but we need to ask ourselves and to continue asking ourselves if we are on the right track with these initiatives, and also if we're doing enough, and how we can learn from each other when we try to manage our impact on biodiversity and also ultimately our dependency on biodiversity. Biodiversity is not a simple topic at all. And to my knowledge, there is not even a clear perception of what we actually mean with biodiversity. There's a great deal of drivers and elements in biodiversity. So where to begin? Well, today we will make a start with painting a picture of what diversity actually is and how it is developing, and also how we can relate biodiversity to companies, public listed companies, and thus to investors investing in these companies, and how they can manage their impact on biodiversity. So to do this, I am delighted to introduce to you two excellent speakers in this field. As you can see the pictures now, starting with Reinier Hille-Riis-Lambers. What a beautiful name. Reinier is the lead of the Biodiversity Environment Program at ESG. So the acronym is very well known to investors, ESG, but it means in your case, Environmental Sciences Group of the WUR, the Wageningen University. Reinier's work is focused on supporting a transformative change to biodiversity, to a biodiversity inclusive society. And one example is the Biodiversity Environment Program, and where they're designing a platform for civil society and impact. And also the work is kickstarting a wide dialogue, a dialogue around different perspectives on biodiversity. So this is our expert on what biodiversity actually is. Then Peter van der Werf, Peter van der Werf, he's the team lead of engagement and active ownership at Robeco. His expertise include impact investing, labor rights, supply chain management, and also biodiversity. And he focuses mainly on food and agri sector. And it's nice that Peter is also related to the VUR, because he has a master's in environmental science, if I remember well, from Wageningen University. And then in the left bottom, there is Romy Gumica. We are very happy that Romy from IUCN Netherlands will wrap up this webinar in the end and close it. Romy is is the expert on green economy at IUCN Netherlands, and she's a project lead for different IUCN Netherlands programs focused at protection of nature by business and financial sector engagement, both in the Netherlands as well as in countries in Ghana and Tanzania. So in her role, Romy seeks to connect different orbits of nature and business that move apart in different circles, but she, starts in slowly turning them to one another. All right, so now these are the speakers of today. Let's move on to the ground rules. Well, one of them is very accurate. Please put all your mics on mute. I still hear one single one every now and then. If you have questions, then yes, they can be asked in the chat, and we will come back to them at a later moment during the webinar. We also have two polling questions for you prepared, and they can also be answered in the chat. They will introduce an introduction to the speakers. And then after the webinar, we will share the slides with you, and also it will be available for you on the website of the VBDO. So let's get started and move to the first poll question to introduce Reinier. If it goes well, you can all see now in the chat the question appearing. It is, what are the biggest factors contributing to biodiversity decline, according to you? Please go ahead and answer. I'll give you about 1 minute. Yes. Okay. I think we're going to close now. Hope you've all been able to finish the poll. Right. So here we can see your answers appearing in the chat as well. And I would like to ask Reinier to reflect on that and tell us if we see it rightly or wrongly. Please, Reinier.
Good morning, everyone. So I hope you all managed to get the pop quiz right. Good challenge in the morning, but I think most of you actually got it right. The change in land and sea use is actually, which includes deforestation, as one of the factors, is the biggest factor contributing to biodiversity decline. Interesting to see invasive species, no one answered. It's certainly not the biggest, it's the least, but direct exploitation of organisms was the second largest, primarily in the sea marine environment. So that's interesting to see that some of you didn't answer that. But all in all, I think very good. nice to see the responses. No, sorry. So should I go continue?
Yes, please. Yeah, go ahead. Yes, I think so. Yes.
All right. So just a quick, we've already had an introduction. It's really nice. I'm really happy to be here today talking about biodiversity, the financial sector, and deforestation, especially also looking forward to a dialogue. I think that's very important. And I think for my program, it's important for the dialogue aspect of it. It is important because biodiversity, I've been framed as the expert, and I am to a certain extent, but to a certain extent, we are all experts in our own individual ways of relating to biodiversity. Next slide, please. I'll give you a quick overview, relying heavily on some of the information from the IPBES, the Intergovernmental Panel on Biodiversity and Ecosystem Services, who have done some excellent work in taking the reviewing, I think, some 14,000 different papers on where are we in biodiversity and what's affecting it. So I think we can be pretty conclusive that this is a pretty good summary. So let's take a look at this relates to the previous question, right? If you look on the right-hand side, these are the examples of declines in nature on the, and as you move to the left, you see the direct drivers and then the indirect drivers. The direct drivers there, you can see that the consensus is that the largest factor is land and sea use change. Now that includes deforestation, but also forest degradation, other aspects affecting global biodiversity. We know that the forests, I think, contain some 80% of terrestrial species. So that's a large factor there. But what's important here is also the indirect drivers. It's not mere what is causing those trends in deforestation and land use change. Well, the consensus also there is that it seems to be a large part of it seems to be consumption, changing habits in consumption, primarily Western, but also increasingly in non-Western societies, changing their habits, and that's compounded also by a population growth. Behind that, I think that's important, is also the values and behaviors driving that. So what is driving our move in society to eat differently, consume differently, I want to say exploit, but I think that's the wrong word, use differently. Next slide, please. So biodiversity, IPBES has taken a view, and I'm very supportive of that, looking at what biodiversity means is nature's contributions to people. That is, in a sense, it's an all-encompassing word, looking at the how basically the fabric of life, shorthand for biodiversity, affects us all. To these children in this picture, biodiversity will mean something very different than to an indigenous tribe in the Amazon, or to a small to an oil palm smallholder in Indonesia or Malaysia, or to a scientist, or to companies or investors, but it's important that we encompass these different views, right? So next slide, please. And so how, if we look at this, how are we doing in terms of nature's contributions to people? Looking at the different categories, we are showing a decline in those different categories. And these categories range from one thing such as habitat creation or regulation of air quality to also things as basically medicinal results or physical and here I'm going to read that because I can't read it, psychological experience, something which we've all probably in these pandemic times have been very grateful to nature for providing. And you know, after a long day of WebExes and Skypes, going out into a piece of nature and experiencing something differently, but we're seeing its decline. Moving on to the next slide, what are we doing about it? Well, progress is lagging. Progress is lagging, and just to be very to cut it short, I think These are the summary of progress towards the Aichi goals. The Aichi goals are part of the Convention of Biological Diversity, which was scheduled this year, now postponed to next year, which is basically 195 governments agreeing on what to do. But in 2020, we were supposed to review where we are. Well, planning has seemed to gone very well. And on the shorthand, things such as working on the actual pressures of biodiversity decline has gone less well. So that's kind of the summary here. So we need, next slide, please, conclusion also of IPBES that a transformative change is needed. And this is exciting because a transformative change is basically a system-wide reorganization, which includes the whole society in working on it. And that is, I think, what's important. It's an inclusive term, which explicitly includes investors, companies, civil society, and universities and research centers such as Wageningen. So next slide, please. I'll just quickly highlight that there is, in general, a potential for investment, that if you look at the cost of biodiversity restoration, they've been estimated somewhere between 150 to 140 billion US dollars, but that the cost of inaction on specifically for land degradation, three times higher, but the benefits have been estimated at 10 times higher than the costs. Now, what type of potential business case does that mean? We can get into that later. But one thing is clear, there's a gap in finance in moving biodiversity restoration forward. Next, and one thing I'd also like to highlight, potential harmful subsidies are also around the 500 billion a year. So there you go. Maybe that's already something we can work on. Where should investors focus? Well, this is an important concept. This is the mitigation hierarchy. And what it means is basically the steps one, if you're looking at your impact on biodiversity for companies, the steps you should take. One, if you look at the right-hand side, this is your net, perhaps negative impact on biodiversity. As a first step moving forwards to the, moving towards the right, you should first take steps to avoid, then minimize, then rehabilitate, and then if there is any residual impact, you should compensate. But I think this provides an interesting aspect that, that also it's important to move towards net positive impact. And I think that's a real challenge for investors and companies in us in moving towards a positive impact, not merely mitigating what is the negative impact. Next slide, please. One of the things my questions is, and I think before moving over to paper, is can investments in the way we invest actually help the transitions are needed? The important point for this slide, I think, is two things, is that if you're looking at a change, you're not looking, this is not my work, by the way, references below that, is that you have both a disruption path, which is phasing out the old or phasing out the stuff we don't want anymore, as well as an innovation path, which is phasing in the new and stuff we do want. And my question is, how can investments help us move not only on the disruption path by mitigating or avoiding biodiversity loss, but also on the innovation path, which is moving towards biodiversity inclusive business models, investments which promote net positive biodiversity gains. So next slide, please. There's many challenges and opportunities. To cut it short, I think it's interesting. I'd love to hear Peter's views as well. And one of the things that I'm very aware of is that what those net positive business cases are, of course, I think we might agree that we need to go there. But what is needed for that? It's probably not a simple thing. And what is needed for investors, and specifically mainstream investors, to commit to net positive biodiversity impact portfolios?
Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you, Reinier. Thanks very much. Really, thank you so much for this excellent and condensed and clear presentation on such an extremely complex topic. Thanks very much. We don't have time, but we're going to do take one question. I see in the chat from Sanne van Keulen. I'm not sure if you can read it, the question as well, Reinier. But Sanne asks, the definition of biodiversity. Yeah. Okay, everyone can read it then, I think.
Maybe yes, I'll read it. It's about definition of biodiversity. It seems to, when you read it, it seems to exclude the rights of species. That's a big debate. However, I think the IPBES actually did formulate it so that it included those types of rights of species. Nevertheless, the debate on the rights of species is a debate, and that's perhaps more my personal thing, is a debate which is debated by people. Mm-hmm. And whether we agree that there are rights of species or not, then I think that is a thing that people are debating right now.
Okay, thanks, Reinier. Before we move to the debate between you and Peter later on, let's move to the second polling question, and as an introduction to the presentation of Peter. So please, all of you, what do you think investors should be doing? Should they develop policies to limit investments in companies with negative impact on biodiversity? The poll question is in your chat. Please, in the next minute, give us your ideas on that. Yes, I think, were we there? Yes, we're there. Okay. There we go. That's divided, not completely evenly, but all boxes are ticked. And Peter.
Thank you, Jacqueline. Yeah, so interesting results indeed from the poll. I think it shows that that people are still divided, although the answer no calculating impact is not possible hasn't been ticked. So I think everybody is aware of the need to take action, and it's really the question to what extent can we expect action from investors. So my name is Peter Vandenwerf. I'm a senior engagement specialist at Robeco, and I lead the engagement efforts of our team. Over the past 9 years, I've spent a lot of time engaging myself with companies in various supply chains that ranges from palm oil and soy, beef, from other animal protein, coffee, tea, actually a whole host of supply chains, which Robeco as a mainstream asset manager has investment exposure to. And I think from that work also stems my current focus, where I look more into detail into biodiversity. So this year we've embarked on a research project looking very specifically at biodiversity loss due to deforestation. So also happy to see the answers for the first poll question, where many of you indicated that that land and sea use change is really sort of driving most of biodiversity loss. And that's also what we found in our initial analysis. Also, after reading the IPBES report last year, that really sparked a lot of discussions within our firm with investment analysts and with sustainability specialists, as in how can we, as an asset manager, reduce our impact. And I think that's the phase also where you see also coming out of the second poll, where most investors, I think, currently are focusing on is that first step in the diagram that Reinier showed, where you're moving from a negative impact into avoiding part of that impact. And I think that is really also key in the discussions that I had as a member of the Partnership for Biodiversity Accounting Financials, who will be presenting in the next webinar as well that the VBDO is hosting next week. And within that group, I also indicated, as a global asset manager, our first step is really understanding what our biodiversity impact is. And I think for that, we've identified within our engagement program as a first step, and that's obviously only focusing on 12 companies out of the 3,000 that we invest in. So it means that there's a lot of scope for additional research after this program, but we currently focus on getting a better understanding of the actual sourcing footprint. So focusing on the question, can these companies achieve 100% traceability of the raw materials which they source, which in this case is beef, soy, tropical timber, cocoa, and rubber, as sort of the highest deforestation impacted supply chains. We did palm oil last year already, and that's where biodiversity has also a clear role in how we look at it. For palm oil, we actually made a policy where Robeco has decided to only invest in companies that have that are a member of the Roundtable on Sustainable Palm Oil and have at least 20% of their plantation certified. And we then also engage with all of the companies we invest in to see that after 3 years, they at least meet 50%. So that's where we've sort of codified in a policy how we deal with palm oil, given the huge reputational impact, obviously, that investing in palm oil has. Many of you are aware of that as investors, the questions you get around that. And for us, the RSPO is a good starting point. It's not to us a sort of a answer to everything. That engaging with these companies is really important, but at the same time, we do see that it's a very good starting point for these discussions. For many of these other supply chains, this is not feasible yet. So that's where we're currently doing research on what can we expect from these companies. And one of the clear asks, the main ask is, can you provide us with 100% traceability? Because if you have that visibility on where the actual sourcing takes place, then you also know if there has been forest that has been cut down for the production of, for instance, soy there. If not, can those farmers and those traders also provide you with evidence that they have not been deforesting that land in previous years? So asking for a cutoff date, for instance. There's a large debate now in the Cerrado in Brazil to find a cutoff date for production of soy, because there's still ongoing deforestation there, similar to what the soy moratorium has done in the Amazon. And so these are all steps where investors can be involved in making ultimately a market transition from where sort of currently the soy market, as an example, is still very much focused on purely output and most efficient delivery to your end clients in Europe, in the US, or in China, when you look from a Brazil perspective. And that's where we want to add a deforestation-free element to that, because that is ultimately where we can ensure that there is no biodiversity loss. And the same accounts for all of the global food companies. And that is also where I think many of the investors have their main investment exposure, is through the large global food players, because they are sourcing all of these ingredients. And so I think that's where it starts. So for us, it starts with identifying where is your impact. The second step is how can we engage with companies to reduce, so to avoid that impact. And then going into that mitigation hierarchy, I think the next steps will be not only doing this for the 12 companies that I have in my research project now, but actually making this feasible for the 3,000 companies we invest in as a manager every year. And then moving into, so having a full biodiversity footprint for the company. And then moving into, and what is then an acceptable amount of biodiversity loss? I think we have to be realistic that as we are moving from 7 billion people up to 9 or even 10, and these projections are shifting, but let's say with a peak of 9.7 in 2064, which I read the latest research yesterday, then we still have a lot of potential biodiversity loss that is initially expected due to expansion of agricultural production. And I think that's where we also need to be realistic, that we can't expect all of our investments currently not to have any impact. And I think that's where we ultimately need to set boundaries of what is sort of acceptable in terms of deforestation and what is really resulting in too much deforestation and therefore too much biodiversity loss. And that is ultimately where we are then moving into making this feasible for all clients and all other stakeholders to read this in a biodiversity impact report. And then ultimately with that, we are then able to also share this knowledge with other investors. I think that is sort of a hierarchy of steps that we see ahead of us when it comes to biodiversity. I think it's very clear to Robeco that biodiversity loss is one of the sort of twin emergencies next to climate change. And therefore, we need to really set bold targets and take a lot of concerted efforts with other investors to ultimately address this. And with that, I would like to close my remarks and open up for the dialogue.
Peter, thank you very much. Also very interesting to hear from your side what investors like Robeco actually are already doing in this field and how many, what's happening there. And also, how clearly you put it in those three steps. Before you go into dialogue, also, I'd like to give you the opportunity to answer one of the questions in the chat. I think a good question came in from Bas Knoll about at 9:28. Maybe you can read it as well there as well. So I think it's a very relevant question on the divesting in biodiversity. Well, what is the impact of divesting a company in the real world?
Exactly. Now, that is very important. Obviously, when a lot of companies, a lot of investors would say, we will not finance this company, that would have an impact. But in most cases, you're just changing hands in terms of shares. As we are divesting, another party is buying them, and therefore there is little impact at that moment on the company. I think engagement for us therefore is also the strongest impact that we as an asset manager can have. Next to that, and that is also part of the debate, I think there is also this market for biodiversity restoration that also Rainier mentioned already. The challenge there is, and that is I think also one of the questions that I had for the debate with Rainier, is how can we create a business case for this biodiversity restoration? Currently, Robeco and many other many of our clients, so large pension funds, insurers, sovereign wealth funds, they have a majority of their exposure to listed equity. And currently, biodiversity restoration does not fit in there. So it's more project finance, it's more sort of dedicated projects that you need to look for to really have a clear impact on biodiversity restoration. And I think that is where there's still a lot of work that needs to be ongoing, where similarly to a market for carbon credits, I could also envision a market for biodiversity credits, which is currently not available yet, or there's only very patchy small projects available, which don't fit into the investment mandate that we get from our clients. And I think that's where we still need to make steps, as in, can we ultimately also bring that into scope?
Great, Peter, thanks very much. And also, I think you already posed a good kick-off question for a discussion for Rainier here what can investors do to build this business case also for the restoration part?
Well, I think it's also a bit of a chicken and the egg problem, right? It's clear that the financing restoration landscape is inadequate in the sense that the financing for it's coming, but it's not at the right stages. I think in all these things, when we're looking at the future, in wicked problems, it's good to start with small wins or small examples, right? So there's already examples in which, for example, in partnerships with, for example, I'll name the Rabo, WWF, and a few others looking in the Netherlands, maybe not as much as deforestation, but at the restoration of farmland landscapes, building biodiversity monitors, kind of inclusive with all the different stakeholders that are trying to reward restoration of biodiversity. I think in small, those are steps which I think could be part of also maybe if we're looking at palm oil or deforestation, those are interesting things, which the question is, can we also change the landscape somewhat through those types of initiatives which are multi-stakeholder and try to promote transparency and try to promote the incentives to increase biodiversity, as mm-hmm. it were. That's one way I think we could look at it. But the other is, I think it's already been mentioned, a lot of the restoration activities are early stage, high risk, maybe more suitable for impact investing. But in that case, I also think, or project finance, but in that case, I do think there's also a role for companies and investors to play in that. And the question is what, but I think blended finance and landscape finance, some of those concepts are things which are maybe not an early stage, but still need to be rolled out a bit. But I think that requires us all to play a part in the research. I think that needs to be done on that is also, there may still be a few questions on that. Mm-hmm. Sure, so happy to hear that as well. This is as much a dialogue with everyone here on the challenges facing us on that.
Thanks. Yeah. Mm.
Do you want me to continue or should we look for questions? I mean,
maybe Peter would like to react on what you just brought forward.
Yeah, I think it's a very important concept to look at which investors can play a role in which stage. But there, it's very important to keep in the back of our minds what is ultimately the assignment that a investor gets from the people that put up money with them. And that's for a asset manager working for pension funds or for others, very different from an organization that is actively looking for opportunities to create also social impact through, for instance, blended finance options and others. So I think that's really where and that also accounts for the larger global banks and others in terms of their financing activities. So making biodiversity a positive biodiversity impact inclusive in the economic model, I think that is really the main challenge. And one of the remarks made by Bas Volkers is if you accept biodiversity loss, you're in a dead end road. And I think that's also one of the main challenges for sort of how we operate our economic system now is how do we make ecosystem services, biodiversity and others basically inclusive into our full valuation model instead of seeing those as externalities. And to a certain extent, how we treat that with Robeco is that we sort of on a short, mid and long term project in our valuation models how these impacts can have an effect. So if we are looking at investing in a beef producer in Brazil, which obviously has a very large risk exposure to deforestation and therefore to biodiversity loss, we take these factors into account in taking a discount on their fair value because we price in part of that biodiversity risk already in how we look at the valuation of their stock. This could still mean that ultimately when we think it's not priced fairly by the market and we still see an upside that we will invest in that company. But at the same time, it immediately triggers the fact that we will engage with that company because we see that there is a large impact on biodiversity. And therefore, that investment decision coincides with a decision to start engaging with that company. And that might also change over time if we set stricter rules for how much biodiversity impact we accept. And that is a process we're currently ongoing. We're setting up a task force within our company to start bringing these type of questions into scope and also really focus on how we can shape our investment policy along those lines. And similar debate is ongoing for climate change. And I think many investors are making these steps, but at the same time, we also have to look at how can we still deliver competitive returns compared to our competitors. And I think that's where ultimately we need a level playing field because these challenges are ahead of all investors. It's not only that the sustainable investors should care about biodiversity because also the large mainstream investors will face similar challenges in the future that the value of their investments will be impacted if ecosystem services are strongly in decline.
Yeah. Hear to that. Can I react to that? That's great, Peter. I was just wondering, I'm looking at your Robeco, and as an asset manager, of course, you manage assets for others. So So my question is, I'm looking at your portfolio, right? You have approximately 6 billion in sustainability focused funds, right? Right now, some assets under dialogue, which I think is the largest component of your portfolio you manage. And I'm just wondering, is what would be needed to help move into restoration focused funds?
That's a very interesting question, because I think that really also depends on the conversation that we're having with our clients, as in what is ultimately what they want to achieve. So we have developed over the past years a set of investment products that is focused on making a positive contribution to the sustainable development goals. So for instance, there, we will not select a beef producer because it scores negatively on its contribution to the sustainable development goals. So there we have a very clear mandate to only select companies that have a positive impact. So we will not select a beef producer, but we might select a dairy producer with a very strong focus on sustainability, or we might select another type of company which does not have a negative impact. And I think that's where sort of also the debate is out, as in how clients ultimately are reshaping their own focus on what type of assignment they are giving to their asset manager. And that is a constant debate where we are presenting a lot of facts on, but these investment portfolios can make similar and in some periods even better investment returns than the standard investment product. And I think that's ultimately, yeah, where we are educating our clients.
Yes. Thanks. And it's also what kind of asset manager are the clients looking for? I mean, the asset manager itself has also, you also have your own standards, I assume.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah.
One interesting question that Annemiek Vromans mentioned in the chat is on changing habits, so from meat to plant consumption. In one of the programs I did before on improving sustainability in the meat and fish supply chain, that's where we had one objective really focusing on that topic. And I think that's also where you actually see that a lot of the changes can also be driven by consumers, because ultimately that difference between feeding beef or having a plant-based menu is eight to nine times a difference on average of its footprint. And I think that's also where ultimately our investment analysts are also looking at where are these trends moving. And if these trends are accelerating beyond Western Europe and the US into a global trend, and if people start to follow the eat lentil diet with a much smaller amount of animal protein in there and a much larger amount of plant protein, at that moment, that's where we also see the bigger shifts. But obviously, as an investor, we are also following where these trends are. Currently, meat consumption globally is still on the rise because the emerging middle class is still looking to change to a Western diet.
Yes. Yes, we all have to change our behaviors actually here, not only investors, consumers, also asset owners. I agree. So I was just keeping track of the time.
Oh, yeah.
The discussion just started, but I think we covered also a lot of things already. Thanks very much, Peter, and also Reinier for your contributions and this discussion. I would like to give the floor now to Romy and Romy Goedeke of ISDN to do a short wrap up of what's been said and to put an end to close actually then also this webinar. Romy, are you there?
I am. Thank you, Jacqueline. I hope you can all hear me. So it's a bit of a daunting task, of course, to summarize all that we discussed before, but I'll give it a go. So I think most importantly, nature is the basis of life. And as Reinier explained, according to the most recent IPBES report, an estimated 1 million species are under threat of extinction. Healthy societies, resilient economies, and thriving businesses rely on nature. So we need transformational change to seek lasting solutions. The postponed 15th meeting of the Conference of the Parties to the Convention on Biological Diversity, which is planned to take place in Kunming in January next year, will be the last moment to agree on effective measures to reverse nature loss in the decade and to ensure ecosystem resilience. the realizations of these new ARCHI targets will only be possible by concerted action by all relevant stakeholders and by each actor taking their own responsibility, whether you're a consumer, a business, or a financial institution. We think financial institutions should make every effort to take their responsibility and contribute to the protection and restoration of biodiversity and ecosystem via financing activities and investments. As Peter explained, the first step is the need to measure impacts, to start managing that, and on the basis of that, look for space for improvement. This cannot be done alone. So lessons have to be drawn and collaborations have to be sought. We also spoke about challenges. I noted down two. First, how do you make externalities like biodiversity impacts part of financial validation models? But we also spoke about an equal level of playing field. So what if Robeco steps out of investing into a certain company and an other investor steps in? The impact of nature will be zero. IUCN Netherlands Committee has been working with the financial sector for a number of years on three topics. So first of all, we're working on developing investable landscape programs to bridge the gap between landscape initiatives and the finance sector. Secondly, we engage with investors to improve their impact on nature. And thirdly, we work to inform international tool development and policy. Earlier this year, we launched a guide to help organizations navigate the world of biodiversity footprinting tools. Based on our track record, the Dutch Ministry of Agriculture and Food Quality, known as LNV for us Dutch speakers, asked IUCN Netherlands together with NVO Netherlands to collect and promote actions by Dutch non-state actors, such as financial institutions, towards the realization of the CBD action agenda. Today, we're compiling and mapping non-state initiatives to bring about an ambitious Dutch contribution to the new targets of the Convention on Biological Diversity. So if you're interested to learn more about this or commit your pledge, there should be a link to our website online and an email address for my colleague working on this project full-time. So thank you for your attention, and that was my contribution.
Thank you very much, Romy, for this, well, for highlighting this again and for your summary, also for bringing about the pledge. Thanks very much. Thank you very much, Reinier, again, and Peter, for your excellent contributions. And also thanks very much, all the participants, and for the questions you asked. We will maybe try to answer the questions via email or otherwise. The email addresses are all, I think, available of the speakers if called for. We look forward to the next webinar next week. It will be in the afternoon. We will have someone from Washington, D.C. calling in, and from IUCN worldwide. And then we will talk more about measuring actually the impact on biodiversity. Another good topic. Thanks very much. Look forward to seeing you next week. Bye-bye.
Thank you all. Bye-bye.
Thanks so much.
Thank you.
Bye all.
Bye.
Bye all. Bye.